Okay lah eh. Kita start lah. Okay, so bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Very good morning to everyone. So I do hope that everybody in good shape right now. Mentally, physically, emotionally. Okay? Okay, so regarding our assignment, I would like to just explain again regarding our assignment. Okay, so there are two assignments actually. Okay, so there are two types of assignment in which both need to be conducted in groups, but there are some part of the assignment within the group that need to be done individually. Okay, so overall we have two assignments. Okay, the first one group management skill assignment and then applied conflict assignment. Okay, so let's proceed with one of the details regarding each assignment. So the first assignment, 30%, which is on the conflict management skill assignment. Okay, in which you are required to choose either one. Either you are interested to proceed with negotiation role play video or mediation role play video. It is up to you. Okay, you can choose either one. Because in terms of the marking, it's just similar when I divide the arrangement of the assignment to is similar. Okay, so the first one, if let's say you are interested to do the negotiation role play, the first thing that you need to do is you need to submit one paragraph summary describing the conflict that your group would like to address. Okay, so you need to, this is the first thing that you need to do. Means that when you want to do this this group assignment, first thing that you need to do is you need to create one group folder within your Dropbox. Okay, so within that group folder, you need to have another two subfolders.
Bluetooth mode.
Okay, first create one group folder. Okay, and then within that group folder, we need to have two subfolders. The first subfolder is for the conflict management skill assignment. Okay, up to you. If you choose the negotiation, then you may rename that folder as negotiation. Okay, so negotiation role play. So in this negotiation role play video, first you need to submit one paragraph summary. You need that describe the conflict that you want to do. Okay, within your group lah, just one paragraph. I just need to review. Okay, so example for this one, I will just show you. This is based on the group that already shared lah. I give the example. Semua orang boleh nampak tak? Ini daripada grup Syafian lah eh. Saya bagi dia punya contoh, dia summary. Ini dah dia. Saya bagi contoh. Okay. So ini contoh yang dia hantar. Okay, so just one paragraph lah. Tapi kalau if you want to make it clearer pun should be better. So tapi sebenarnya saya akan tengok. Ni je sebenarnya. Saya nak tahu you all nak buat apa. Ini sahaja sebenarnya ada you all punya plot tu terpulang tu, so biasanya saya akan minta you all pilih satu sahaja sebenarnya. Okay, so saya nak ini sahaja. Okay, ini bila you all submit ni automatically you will get 2 marks automatic. Okay, itu yang pertama. And then 23 points ni, you work in group, then you prepare the video. Okay, so the video ni depends on your creativity lah. Okay, so I'm sure, I know that you cannot mobilize during mobilize yourself during this COVID-19, but you can do your creativity lah, meaning that perhaps you assign a member, you assign the task according to the member. So dia orang kena shoot individually ke, then submit the video to you, and then there's one group that responsible to combine or integrate all the videos according to your according to your plot and so on. So ini pembahagian markah ni terpulang saya letakkan pembahagian markah. So your video should be less than 5 minutes. Okay, and then it is related to the best practice of negotiation skill. Okay, and then kat sini ni tak semestinya upload dekat YouTube lah eh. Kalau tak ada, tak apa. Then you just upload within your folder. Should be okay for me. Okay, and then markah ni adalah 13%. 13 markah adalah untuk content. Okay, maksudnya the clear content yang you all sampaikan tu. Okay, and then the quality of the video 5 markah. Dan daripada segi kejelasan suara, daripada segi kejelasan video tu sendiri. Okay, and then include description. Kalau you all masukkan description, maksudnya setiap teknik best practice that you use during the negotiation process tu, then will be evaluated here. Okay. Ini 23 markah. And then another 5 points, after you submit a 2 or 3 page reaction paper analyzing the negotiation process, its impact on the conflict and implication for practice of future research. So this one also based on individual. Okay, so individual ni, you need to submit individually lah within your group folder. Okay, so group, sorry, individual folder. Okay, so this one for example eh, saya share sebab sekarang tak ramai lagi yang share. Okay, so ini yang group tadi. So sekarang ni ini yang individu. So setakat ni, meaning that yang untuk that assignment, you just insert within your individual folder. Okay, so setakat ni ini yang saya terima lah eh, yang dah successfully share their individual folder. Okay. Okay. So nanti you all just letak dalam ni sahaja. Okay, so next one. Ada soalan tak berkenaan dengan negotiation ni? Negotiation role play. Ada soalan? Please make sure that you are clear. Clear betul-betul. Apa yang kena buat. Okay, next one adalah.
Doktor.
Boleh tak?
Apa dia? Apa dia? Ha, satu-satu.
Okay, doktor. Berkenaan dengan video tu, doktor. Tadi doktor dah maklum dengan saya untuk sertakan teknik dia kan dalam kita punya video tu. Boleh tak doktor nak mohon bantuan doktor untuk jelaskan macam mana lagi, doktor? Oh. Saya agak kurang jelas dengan part tu.
Okay, tak apa. Saya habiskan yang mediation ni. Nanti saya akan tunjuk satu contoh based on my previous student. Okay, saya tunjuk contoh. Okay, so mediation ni pun sama juga dengan negotiation ni. So sama juga dia punya dia punya kriteria sama. It's just this one mediation. So you need to prepare 5 minutes video on best practice mediation skill in the context that is of interest to you. Okay, and then write to 3 pages. Okay, so kita tengok point dia. Okay, so 2 point sama you all akan dapat bila you submit 1 paragraph summary describing the conflict your work your group would like to address. Okay, so saya akan tengok dan automatically you all akan dapat 2 markah tu. Saya takkan potong. Okay, 2 markah tu takkan saya takkan potong, even though there are some changes that I might suggest within your within your document. Walaupun ada recommendation, tapi saya takkan potong markah kat sini. As long as you submit, you akan dapat 2 markah. Okay, and then next one 23 marks ni related to your video. Okay, in which the video should be 5 minutes and less. Okay, and then it is related to the best practice of mediation skill in the context that is of interest to you. Okay, and then marks ni will be given based on content, 13 marks, quality, 5 marks and included description. Ada deskripsi dalam setiap teknik mediasi yang you all gunakan. Okay, and then 5 point juga akan diberikan selepas you submit 2 or 3 page reaction paper analyzing the negotiation process. So yang 5 point ni dia sebenarnya after you prepare the video ni, apa you all boleh komen secara individunya, apa yang you all rasa you all boleh komen tentang video yang you all buat, the best practice yang you all apply. Is it good? Ni saya nak you all punya critical individual critical thinking lah. Kalau you think that it is good enough, okay, then why? Kalau you all thinks that there might be some improvement related to the technique that you use, then what is it? Okay, so
dia macam kesimpulan lah, doktor.
Apa dia?
Dia macam kesimpulan individu lah, apa yang kita faham mengenai
dia bukan individu. Dia bukan kesimpulan juga, dia reaction. So maksudnya based on video yang kita buat, kalau kesimpulan ni kita just summarize kan. apa yang kita kita maksudnya based on video yang kita buat, kita bagi feedback kita sendiri. Based on apa kerja yang you all buat, you all rasa apa kelebihan teknik yang you all gunakan dalam contohnya, contohnya kalau dalam teknik apa tu negotiation, so you all guna iMessage. Contoh, you guna iMessage. So apa kelebihan penggunaan iMessage? So you think that penggunaan iMessage ni boleh membantu dalam proses negosiasi ke tak? Contoh, apa lagi teknik yang you all rasa perlu digunakan? Saya bukannya nak suruh you all kata apa kelemahan video you all. Tak, saya tak tahu, saya tak tengok markah, saya tak apa tu, saya tak potong markah kat situ. It just I want you to critically comment about the video yang you all produce ni. So apa lagi penambahbaikan yang sebenarnya kita, yang you all boleh propose in secara individunya, so that the process of mediation or negotiation process ni it will end better. Dia boleh berakhir dengan satu cara yang lebih baik. Sebab tak semua proses negotiation ataupun mediasi ni berakhir dengan apa tu agreement of both parties. Ada yang tak berjaya pun.
Doktor, macam nak tanya, kalau maksudnya kita bagi apa ni, macam refleksi paper ni berkenaan dengan kita punya video lah, video kita sendiri.
Betul, yang video kita sendiri. Apa lagi sebab lah kita pun tahu kan bila kita buat sesuatu teknik, there is no one technique that fix all. Kan? Tak ada satu pun teknik mediasi, sama ada kalau you all guna apa tu, you all guna approach accommodate ke apa competing ke, tak, dia tak akan fit untuk semua situasi. Okay, so bila satu teknik negosiasi ataupun mediasi yang kita gunakan tu, okay, dia kena fleksibel. Cuma ada masa tertentu setiap orang ataupun setiap kumpulan ni dia prefer to use one teknik. Selain daripada teknik tu, apa lagi teknik yang you all rasa sebenarnya boleh juga diguna pakai untuk situasi konflik yang you all pilih ni? Faham? Ini untuk reaction paper ni.
Faham, cikgu.
Ya, alhamdulillah. Okay, so tadi kawan kita tanya macam mana lagi nak produce yang video ni. Okay, so last lagi sekali saya tunjuk apa tu the assignment daripada kawan student saya sebelum ni. Kawan-kawan kita lah . Saya tunjukkan. Mana tak videonya?
Doktor nak tanyalah, kalau contoh macam kita buat video tu kan, bila kita kan macam kita set video kan, dia buat short dia sendiri kan, tambah-tambah masa bila kita compile tiba-tiba lebih pula 5 minit, macam mana? Takpelah kan?
cuba jadikan cuba buat mungkin dua versi, tengok satu versi yang kita cuba kita compresskan less than 5 minit, lagi satu versi asal tu. Cuba tengok, kalau let's say kita tengok versi yang 5 minit tu, rasanya kalau audience tengok dah clear, then okay.
Sebab kita ambil short satu-satu tu kan, bila kita compile kita tahu berapa banyak.
Betul.
Okey. 5 minit. Betul lagi. Jadi 5 yang 5 point yang apa individual paper tu kan. Jadi kita boleh je apa benda kita nak ulas, kita ulas jelah kan.
Yeah.
Apa benda kritik ke apa, basically markah janji kita buat boleh dapat je kan. Salah tu tak ada isu kan.
Yang penting tak ada isu. Yeah.
Idea je kan.
Yeah, saya nak idea je. Idea you all je. Tak keluar ni .
Lepas tu nanti doktor nak tanyalah berkenaan yang apa ni, yang description ni kan? Description ni, apa maksud description ni?
Haa, meh. Nampak? Nampak tak video saya share? Tak nampak eh? Nampak?
Belum lagi.
Haa, ni. Description ni, satu, if let's say you use English. Nampak? Buat dua-dua pula. Okay. Mana dah tadi? Guru hilang. Sekejap eh. Ni saya punya favorite lah. Okay, saya dah tunjuk dah sebelum ni. Yang ni saya punya favorite. Okay. So contohnya, description tu, okay, satu quality. Kalau quality dari segi video tu, you all tahulah kan quality kan. Okay, so daripada segi description eh, satu probably you all masukkan. Kalau let's say you do the session ni with in English, then you provide perhaps the subtitle. Contoh. Okay, so lagi satu.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh dan juga selamat petang. Adik-adik hari ini adalah lagi membincangkan cadangan penamatan bagi pergi. Okey.
Okey, Bu Datuk, pegang cap point ni dia.
Assalamualaikum. Okey.
Bu Datuk, pegang cap point ni dia.
Ni, you all nampak tak yang dia tulis kat sebelah ni? Okay, teknik apa yang digunakan? Procedural. Okay, so dia letakkan labeling kat sini. Bila dia nak guna sesuatu approach tu, sesuatu approach dalam mediation dia tu, dia letakkan info kat sebelah tu. Ni sekarang dia nak guna teknik apa? Procedural. Okay, ni dia letak kat sini. Next one. Apalah, kita tengok ke semua boleh? Kita tengok the whole content boleh? Boleh, kita tengok the whole
boleh.
Content.
Boleh.
Boleh, Doktor.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh dan juga selamat petang. Terima kasih semua yang hadir ke mesyuarat kena penilai dasar pemisah pada objektif mesyuarat kita hari ini adalah bagi membincangkan cadangan penamatan bagi pegawai berprestasi rendah melalui dasar pemisah. Okay. Saya jemput
Encik
Jamal untuk mulakan penerangan.
Terima kasih. Apa yang telah kita kemukakan kepada Yang Berhormat Datuk, pegangan cap point ni dia telah mengalami dah didiagnosis penyakit sedis dan dia punya buah pinggang sejak pada 2016 lagi. Sejak dia dah mengidap penyakit ni, dia dah kedatangan dia agak kurang memuaskan lah, di mana Wak Enol sendiri telah mengambil cuti yang agak panjang, yang justru berdasarkan cuti-cuti inilah, berdasarkan peraturan semasa, beliau kita telah bawa dia kepada lembaga perubatan. Walaupun lembaga perubatan memutuskan bahawa pegawai tak layak untuk dipersyaratkan dan perlu diberikan tugas-tugas ringan. Jadi memandangkan lembaga perubatan ini memutuskan pegawai tidak layak dipersyaratkan, kita letak pegawai dalam program pemantauan yang datuk untuk melihat prestasi pegawai berdasarkan tugas yang kita sediakan kepada beliau. Kita juga bawa pegawai kepada lembaga
kawasan. Tak dengar suara lah datuk.
Doktor, tak dapat dengar suara.
Bifu.
Ni nampak eh saya punya share screen?
Nampak dah tak?
Nak start lagi sekali ke ataupun continue je?
Mulai dari satu-satu objektif.
Suara dengar tak?
Ini adalah bagi membincangkan cadangan penamatan pegawai berprestasi rendah melalui dasar pemisah. Okey. Saya jemput Encik Jamal untuk mulakan penerangan.
Terima kasih.
Okay, sorry sebelum tu saya explain sikit. So untuk dalam kes yang kawan kita pilih ni, dia pilih exit policy in dekat government sector lah eh. Memang policy ni memang diguna pakai. So memang dalam kes ni dia memang betul-betul present the procedure, proses dia macam macam mana exit policy tu berlaku dan apakah langkah-langkah yang dibuat terhadap seseorang pegawai kerajaan sekiranya pegawai kerajaan ni dia sekiranya pegawai ni dia dikira sebagai unfit, okey, tidak sesuai untuk melaksanakan sesuatu tugas. So dia present satu-satu. Okey.
Okey. Yang telah kita kemukakan kepada yang pihak Bapak Datuk, pegawai Encik Puan ni dia telah mengalami dah didiagnos penyakit sleep dan dia punya buah pinggang sejak 2016 lagi. Sejak dia dah mengidap penyakit ni, dia dah kedatangan dia agak kurang memuaskan lah, di mana Wak Ainul sendiri telah mengambil cuti yang agak panjang, yang justru berdasarkan cuti-cuti ni lah, berdasarkan peraturan semasa, bila kita telah bawa dia kepada lembaga perubatan. Walau bagaimanapun, lembaga perubatan memutuskan bahawa pegawai tak layak dibesarkan dan perlu diberikan tugas-tugas ringan. Jadi memandangkan lembaga perubatan ini memutuskan pegawai tidak layak dibesarkan, kita letak pegawai dalam program pemantauan yang datuk untuk melihat prestasi pegawai berdasarkan tugas yang kita sediakan kepada beliau. Kita juga bawa pegawai kepada lembaga kaunseling supaya kita nampak perubahan, kita nak tengok perubahan pada diri beliau lah. Justru kita juga bagi beliau ni kita tukar kepada penilaian supaya penilaian yang dibuat nanti lebih adil kepada beliau.
Terima kasih ya Cik Jamal atas penerangan tersebut. Jadi kita beralih kepada Puan Ailona. Puan Ailona, apa jelaskan? Terima kasih Datuk. Datuk, saya sakit ni dah lama. Saya dah bagi tahu dah dekat bagi semua manusia. Saya tak boleh duduk lama, tak boleh diri lama. Saya kena baring kadang-kadang. Lepas makan ubat, saya kena tidur. Saya dah bagi tahu dah. Tapi orang macam tak nak faham. Saya, orang bagi kerja kat saya. Memanglah dia bagi kerja tu mudah. Tapi saya dah cuba dan minta untuk buat kerja tu dari rumah. Nanti saya hantarlah pun pejabat. Semua ni saya tak nak setuju. Macam mana? Saya bukan minta nak sakit-sakit ni. Saya nak orang faham saya je. Kenapa orang ingat saya nak tipu ke? Saya tak buat kerja ke apa semua.
Bukan macam tu Datuk. Sebenarnya kita dah cuba faham keadaan Puan Ainul ni. Sebenarnya kita dah setuju lah untuk dia datang kerja pada hari Isnin, Rabu dan Jumaat.
Okey. Terima kasih Encik Jamal. Puan Ainul, saya nak tanya. Puan Ainul, sekarang ni apa tanggungan Puan Ainul? Suami saya dah lama tak bekerja sebab dia kena jaga saya. Saya pun ada anak yang tengah belajar lagi. Saya memang nak lagi kerja ni Datuk. Kalau boleh, saya memang tak nak diberhentikan. Sebab saya yang menanggung keluarga. Okey, terima kasih Encik Jamal dan juga Puan Ainul atas penjelasan tadi. Setelah mengambil kira semua asas-asas yang diterangkan pada hari ini, saya kira mesyuarat bersetujulah. Kes pegawai ini mempunyai merit bagi tujuan penamatan perkhidmatan dan juga berdasarkan pemerhatian ke atas pegawai dan juga dokumen sokongan yang dikemukakan. Jadi mengambil kira prestasi kerja dan penilaian psikologi yang ada mengesahkan nilai keberkunaan pegawai ini, jadi mesyuarat bersetuju bahawa Puan Ainul tidak lagi sesuai untuk berkhidmat sebagai pejabat awam. Dan sekiranya pegawai dikekalkan dalam perkhidmatan, pegawai boleh menjejaskan keharmonis dan juga representasi pegawai. Panel bersetuju agar pegawai ditamatkan di bawah dasar pemisah selaras dengan peraturan pegawai awam Kelakuan Data Terkutip tahun 1993. Terima kasih Datuk atas pertimbangan ini. Saya reda atas nasib yang menimpa saya. Saya walaupun saya sedih saya tak dapat berkhidmat lagi, saya percaya jabatan dah buat yang terbaik untuk saya. Terima kasih.
Ada soalan nak tanya? So ini memang prosedur yang diguna pakai lah ya dekat jabat kerajaan, jabatan kerajaan, in which exit policy. So daripada representation case tadi tu memang case dia sebenarnya case tu memang daripada case yang betul, case yang sebenar. Okay, cuma dan dia bawa daripada akta yang dia bawa ni salah satu tribunal lah ya, part of tribunal kalau ada masalah kerja macam ni. Ini contoh. So another contoh example is dalam video-video yang saya ada share dalam slide sebelum ni pun you all boleh juga jadikan sebagai rujukan. Maksudnya bila kita nak buat proses mediation, so pertama sekali kita buat proses ice breaking dulu. Start dengan satu session tu ice breaking. Sebab apa ice breaking? Kita nak tahu, nak perkenalkan diri dengan pihak kita sebagai mediator dengan dua pihak dua pihak yang berkonflik. Okay, then kita ada individual session in which mediator ni dia akan berjumpa dengan setiap setiap pihak, kedua-dua pihak lah secara persendirian. Okay, dia ada sesi bersama kedua-dua pihak ni, and then lastly dia ada sesi penutup. So dia ada tiga sesi, tiga lah betul, tiga sesi yang berbeza pun. Kalau you all guna format ni pun boleh, okay, untuk buat mediation. Okay, so, kalau negotiation ni antara dua pihak je lah. Okay, faham. Ada lagi soalan nak tanya? So berkenaan dengan description tu, itulah description dia. Maksudnya setiap kali teknik yang you all nak pakai, okay, so you all letak kat, you all describekan kat sebelah tu. Apa teknik yang you all pakai? Bila dalam kes ni, okay macam ni. Bila situasi dia jadi macam ni, okay teknik ni. Itu maksud description tu. Okay, ada lagi soalan? Ada lagi benda yang you all tak faham? Make sure betul-betul faham kali ni.
So maksud dia dekat apa yang description tu, macam tadi saya tengok dia ada tulis macam emosi, atau ada tulis result. Maksud dia kita part tu kita beritahu ni berkenaan dengan apa lah kan.
Betul, dia tak semua benda. Maksudnya bila kita dah start ubah teknik kita tu, okay, so you all letak sekarang ni you all ubah teknik apa. Okay, so macam tadi dia procedure tadi tu dia start dengan explaining the procedure lah. Procedure daripada apa ke apa-apa yang dia dah buat, langkah-langkah yang dia dah ambil sebelum ni sehinggalah dah tak boleh nak buat apa. So sampailah tahap tu, tahap in which sekarang ni kita dah bawa ke tribunal, in which kita nak decide sama ada di staff ni dah still fit dengan kerja tu ataupun dah dikira tak fit dan boleh diconsider dalam exit policy. So itu dia punya procedural. So tadi dalam masuk emotional tadi, so selain daripada part procedural ni, sebab kita sebagai manusia dalam, kalau dalam kes tersebut, so kita pun kena consider juga the tanggungan pegawai berkenaan, mana yang kita boleh consider lah. Okay.
Satu doktor, yang video ni ada ikut kan kita hantar bila sebelum ni sebelum habis SEM ni.
Sepatutnya. Sepatutnya. Sekarang ni apa yang tak patut?
Apa yang boleh, tapi kalau kita siap boleh letak dalam video kita punya folder
boleh.
Tu kan.
Ya. Apa lagi soalan? Any question tak ada sini?
Kita kena letak yang dia punya macam subtitle juga kan dekat bawah. Kalau kita buat dalam BM, kita kena buat dalam bahasa Inggeris kan?
Dia macam inilah. Dia tak, tu tak wajib lah. Saya tak adalah mewajibkan. Subtitle tu tak wajib sangat sebenarnya. Dan saya tak rasa, kalau let's say lah ya, sebab kalau I talk, most of us in our class here, we can understand both Malay and English. I'm sure lah kekal ada yang tak boleh faham. Is there anybody that couldn't understand Malay here in this class? Ada tak?
Ada.
So kalau international student,
ada
tak faham? Tak faham bahasa Inggeris ke tak faham bahasa Melayu? Mana satu? Okay, sebab kalau dalam campus, sebab kita ada international student. So bila ada international student ni, we strongly recommend you to prepare in both languages lah. Okay, tapi kalau dalam kelas PDJ ni, I'm sure lah most of us, you can understand. Kalau walaupun tak semua, tapi kita boleh faham sikit-sikit. So sebenarnya pemberat untuk that language tu tak banyak. So yang banyak tu sebenarnya dekat description yang teknik yang kita pakai tu. Sebab saya nak tekankan, sebab nak tekankan kat teknik yang kita nak pakai sama ada untuk mediasi ataupun negotiation tu. Boleh?
Boleh je go.
Lagi ada.
Contoh, kalau contoh macam kita kan, saya tengok dia letak kat belah kanan tu kan, yang description kan. Kalau kita letak dekat bawah ke apa, sebab
boleh.
Kita pun tak tahu skit punya apa. Kita kan pandai sangat pun nak buat tu kan. Jadi kita tulis janji ada sudah kan.
Boleh. Boleh Syafian, boleh boleh. Okay, I'm not sure but kalau yang muda-muda ni mungkin macam Haziq, yang muda Ahmad Haziq, yang muda-muda ni mungkin tahulah kot apa tu software apa yang boleh diguna pakai. Kalau macam saya, saya guna pakai Camtasia. Saya share, saya tak buka. Saya pakai Camtasia. Okay, ni saya rasa yang paling user friendly lah kalau untuk orang-orang umur saya ni. Saya dah tak pandai dekat telefon tu, saya tak ada Android. Sebab biasanya kalau kita nak edit tu mungkin you all boleh pakai Android lah kan. So saya tak pakai Android. So untuk saya macam recording apa semua ni, saya pakai Camtasia ni. Sekejap ya, saya tunjuk. Kalau saya pakai this one. Ini dia saya rasa sedikit user friendly lah untuk kalau saya lah. Sebab senang sangat. Ini saja yang saya pakai ni, Camtasia ni. Okay, so mungkin kalau yang younger generation, so you all mungkin boleh cari option yang lagi senang lah. Okay. Tak perlu apa tu yang macam TikTok pun tak perlulah. Kita untuk just educational purpose. Yang penting video kita jelas. Itu saja. Okay, any other question? Okay, anything that you want to ask? Sebab sometimes when you text me, saya tak puas hati sebab saya tak boleh explain clearly. Sebab dengan WhatsApp tu, as you know lah, I have to declare my weaknesses right now. Sebab bekerja depan laptop, guna banyak jari, tangan saya bila nak naik tu rasa sakit. Sebab tu saya tak berapa suka mesej sebenarnya. Tangan, jari sekarang terlalu kita panggil
krem
betul. Dia krem, dia rasa sakit sangat jari. So sebab ni lah, sebab bila kita bekerja daripada rumah ni, dia punya constraint dia sebab kita terlalu fokus, sebab tak ada macam tak ada break. So kadang-kadang kita terlupa yang kita tu dah bekerja depan depan komputer tu dah sampai 8 hingga 9 jam tanpa henti.
Oh.
Kita terlupa. Terlupa nak break, sebab kadang-kadang kita dah sebelum start kerja tu kita dah breakfast dulu, so dah duduk depan komputer. So straight. So jadi saya terlupa. So jadi membuatkan saya rasa jari dan mental dan saya tak berapa prefer kalau untuk message. So that's why kalau you all nak tanya kat sini. Senang.
Kalau personal boleh tanya.
Tanyalah dalam group. Sebab apa? Sebabnya soalan yang sama tu akan ditanya oleh beberapa student yang lain. So bila you all tanya dalam group, so bila saya jawab, so student lain pun okay akan dapat maklumat yang sama. Kecuali kalau benda yang nak ditanya itu adalah PNC. Bolehlah, faham. Okay?
Okay.
So ada lagi soalan tak nak tanya? Clear betul-betul. Make sure you all betul-betul clear pasal assignment. Sebab sebelum saya masuk kepada topik ni, belum masuk topik lagi ni.
Lepas tu yang apa, yang second assignment tu doktor kan, yang apply complete assignment ni. Ini doktor tak explain lagi kan?
Yang apply pula. Okay. Okay, this one actually, yang second assignment ni, dia sebenarnya report sahaja. Okay, so this one, okay, dua point sama, you all kena submit satu paragraph describing the conflict your group would like to address. Sama je, satu paragraph cukup. 23 point akan diberikan when you produce a report that is 10 to 15 pages long. The paper should provide a brief summary of the conflict, a conflict analysis. This one sebenarnya saya nak you all apply conflict analysis model yang kita dah discuss sebelum ni. Kita dah discuss kan? Yang ada onion, okay, ABC triangle. Okay, so bila macam contoh, contohnya you all ambil conflict yang related to domestic violence, contohnya. Okay, fokus kepada child abuse. Okay, so you all nak guna, you all pilih satu model. Okay, you all dah ada case dan you all pilih satu model. Okay, so contohnya ABC model. Okay, so then you present A tu apa dia, apa yang penyebabnya, B dia apa, C nya apa. So dalam untuk assignment this one, you all boleh apply more than one models. Kalau you all rasa most, sebab ada setengah model tu dia hanya analyze the cause. Mungkin dia tak propose the penyelesaian dia. Okay, so in this case you all boleh combine ataupun integrate two models, two or three models. So that bila you all buat analisis ni, you all tahu apakah punca konflik ni, okay, apakah kesan dia dan apakah cara penyelesaian yang terbaik. So maksudnya kita sebenarnya konflik analisis ni bila kita become a mediator ataupun negotiator dalam sesuatu konflik, so inilah benda yang kita kena buat. Kita kena analisis dulu, kita kena kumpul maklumat dulu, okay, tentang situasi konflik tu. Okay, so then kita boleh, kalau kita bertindak sebagai mediator, then kita boleh propose cara terbaik untuk pihak yang berkonflik ni menyelesaikan konflik dia. Contoh lain adalah kalau let's say you all pilih konflik antara Israel dengan Palestin. Contoh. Okay, you come up with your own analysis. Analysis sendiri. Okay, apa sebenarnya history dia, background of the conflict. Okay, and then dia punya the dynamic, apa perubahan dia. Okay, mungkin kalau dulu it is related to settlement, citizen settlement. So sekarang ni kalau the dynamic dia after decade, so apa dia punya dynamic? So sekarang apa yang you all boleh propose kalau let's say konflik antara Palestin dengan Israel? Itu contoh. Okay, kalau lah you all dilantik sebagai wakil daripada United Nations, so apa yang you all boleh propose? Itu satu. And then another conflict kalau related to commercial conflict. Okay, sebab currently sebab dalam isu COVID-19 ni case commercial conflict, commercial disputes memang bertimbun-timbun. Okay, so selain daripada kita settlekan konflik kita melalui arbitration, okay, arbitration, so kita boleh come up with mediation. So bila kita nak buat mediation sebelum kita buat mediation process ni sebagai mediator, kita kena tahu dulu latar belakang kedua-dua pihak yang berkonflik ni. Okay, so inilah proses yang kat sinilah sebenarnya saya nak address that skill. So maksudnya address macam mana you all nak dapatkan maklumat ni melalui model-model analisis konflik yang kita dah discuss earlier.
Sekejap, Doktor. Yang ni kita nak bawa satu contoh yang real ke, Doktor?
So,
macam Doktor cakap tadi.
Kalau boleh semua real. Okay, sebenarnya this one you all boleh juga tengok kalau you all belum bekerja lah sebab kalau saya rasa kalau you all bekerja dah memang ada dah bekerja, you all memang dah ada experience, so you all boleh je translatekan dalam bentuk case study. Okay, tapi kalau you all belum bekerja, you all boleh refer previous court case, previous awards, court proceeding. Sama ada you all boleh tengok daripada industrial courts ataupun mahkamah session biasa. Banyak je awards case mahkamah yang dah dipublish. So boleh tengok je daripada situ. Okay, so saya prefer a real case. Okay, kalau yang case macam Palestine dengan Israel tu, benda tu obvious. So kita kalau let's say kalau kita dilantik sebagai wakil representative from United Nations, so apa yang kita boleh propose? Okay, then kalau let's say you involve dengan commercial business. Okay, commercial business tak kira lah antara which organisation dengan organisation. Okay, contohnya Huawei dengan iPhone ke, Google dengan iPhone ke, Google dengan Mac ke, contoh. Google dengan Apple, contoh. Okay, dia punya dispute siapa. So itu antara contoh lah. Okay, lagi ada soalan lagi? Ha, ni you just provide the report. Report ni include lah model yang you all buat tu. Okay, and then this one senang je lah. Eh. This one ni saya yang akan masukkan dalam you all. The document ni yang untuk 5 points this one ni, the document ni saya yang akan masukkan dalam folder you all. After you all prepare your individual folder, saya akan masukkan satu document, evaluation document. Saya akan masukkan. You all punya responsibility nanti you all just bagi markah. Okay. Hak ni tak perlu buat apa-apa yang 5 point ni. You all just masukkan je nanti. Okay, and then 10 point ni adalah presentation. So kita tengoklah sempat ke tak ni presentation ni. So sekarang ni dah week 9 ni. 9 ke 10 dah? 10 nak masuk 11 dah. Faham?
Nah, doktor nak tanya lah.
Ya, tanya.
Yang 23 point ni kan? Kan kita kena buat apa ni, produce a report kan? Master report ni macam yang flashy paper lah kan?
Macam
10-15 page ni.
Report ni, okay, first, okay, ni saya dah letak dah format dia. Description of about the conflict today. Maksudnya satu you all kena ceritalah. Sebenarnya this one sama dengan summary of conflict yang you all buat tadi. Ni sebenarnya you all letak describe dulu conflict apa yang you all nak address. Dekat description ni, you all akan letak latar belakang konflik yang berlaku ni. Macam contoh konflik antara Israel dengan Palestin. So you all letak latar belakang dia apa? Itu description dia. Okay, supaya bila saya baca saya faham sebenarnya you all nak address apa dan apa latar belakang kedua-dua pihak yang berkonflik. Okay, dan yang kedua ni you all akan propose conflict intervention strategy. So untuk you all propose conflict intervention strategy ni sama ada melalui mediation, negotiation, litigation, arbitration so on tu, you all need to prepare the analysis dulu. So analysis ni you all kena pilih lah model apa yang you all nak pilih daripada 8 model ataupun banyak-banyak model yang kita present earlier tu, yang saya share earlier. Daripada model tu, you all akan come up dengan analisis. Konflik yang berlaku ni disebab apa? Okay? Dia berlaku sebab apa? Consequences dia apa? So based on this analysis, then you propose the intervention strategy untuk menyelesaikan konflik tersebut. Okay? And then in the paper, student should reference and interrogate. Kalau perlu untuk buat interview dengan mana-mana pihak, then you conduct the interview. Kalau tak boleh nak buat interview, sebab interview sekarang ni tak semestinya buat face to face. You can conduct it online. Okay, but make sure kalau you want to record, make sure you got the consent from the interviewee lah. Okay, kalau tak sempat, then you can come up with document analysis. Document analysis ni maksudnya you all tengok aje past report. Past report ni boleh jadi awards, court, awards proceeding, award daripada mahkamah tu. Sama ada industrial court ke pun boleh. Okay. And then in the papers, okay this one dah. Okay kalau perlu ada teori, you all masukkan teori. Teori ni pun kita dah discusskan earlier. Okay, teori ada model teori ataupun models from class and other outside sources. Okay, so kalau kat sini saya letak student must utilize at least 2 conflict analysis tools in this paper. So maksudnya sebelum you come out dengan intervention strategy yang you all nak propose, you all guna dari sekurang-kurangnya 2 conflict analysis tools. Ke ada yang dah lupa dah? Doktor mana satu conflict analysis tools ni? Tak ingat dah? Cuba tengok balik.
Lebih kurang lah doktor.
Apa dia? Apa dia Izan ni?
Okay, teruskan dia. Okay.
Okay, so faham eh? Ini dia punya proses lah. Maksudnya kalau let's say kita nak jadi mediator sebelum apa-apa kita buat decision, to make sure kita kena ada analisis dulu. Kita buat background check dulu. Inilah dia proses background checknya. Okay, kita cari dulu sumber-sumber yang sepatutnya supaya kita lebih faham konflik yang berlaku.
Oh, ni yang ni grouping kan, doktor kan?
Dia dalam group. Dia dalam group. Tapi you all pandailah divide kan? You all pandailah dividekan tugas tu masing-masing. Okay, sebab nak buat seorang ni susah juga ni dalam tempoh-tempoh sekarang ni. Okay, dia sebenarnya boleh jadi part of research eh. Part of research macam mana kita nak dapatkan maklumat supaya kita completekan paper. Syafian, ini kan salah satu benda yang you all buat sebagai polis kan? Pegawai polis kan? Untuk lengkapkan satu report paper kan? Kertas siasatan tu, bukan ni salah satu proses yang you all buat ke?
Betul. betul. Cuma nak tahu dari segi penulisan lah. Penulisan,
penulisan saya sangat saya sangat suka penulisan yang teknikal. Okay, maksudnya kita nampak benda tu you all buat. Then, saya tak, kalau boleh jangan nampak akademik sangat. Sebab bila kita dalam mediation ni, dia lebih kepada technical report. Okay, tapi kalau perlu letakkan reference, then you all letaklah. You all boleh rujuk akta sebenarnya. Okay, tak pastinya you all rujuk jurnal. You can refer to any existing acts. Okay, any apa tu applicable act. Kalau you all buat yang related to violence act, then refer to violence act. Kalau you all refer to
criminal act.
Kalau yang perlu rujuk ni yang keluarga akta keluarga Islam tu pun rujuk in that one. Okay, depend pada akta yang berkaitan. Itu pun lagi sangat saya cadangkan. Okay, kalau you all bekerja dalam satu organisasi dan you you are okay to share regarding the procedural on how to conduct domestic inquiry within your organisation pun should be okay. Okay, kalau the company okay, maksudnya you all ada procedure tertentu to conduct the domestic inquiry within your organisation, then should be okay. Tapi saya faham organisasi ni dia sangat PNC lah in sharing dia dia punya procedure ni. Okay, so kita boleh ambil general case in which awards proceeding yang ada awards ataupun legal case yang ada dekat online pun itu pun okay. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, lagi ada soalan lagi nak tanya? Dua assignment ni. Settle eh? Okay, so next one ni adalah take home exam. So nanti kita tengoklah sebab exam ni memang saya akan buat online. Okay, so memang online dan biasanya memang saya akan buat soalan ni adalah soalan dalam bentuk esei. Okay, sebab saya rasa dalam keadaan COVID ni saya rasa tak sesuai lah kot soalan subjektif yang objektif. So soalannya dalam bentuk survey pula. Dalam bentuk esei. Okay? Dan tadi saya ada share dengan you all 8 case tadi. Okay, so dalam 8 case tu akan ada satu case yang akan masuk dalam final exam. Okay, dalam 8 tu akan ada satu yang masuk dalam final exam. Okay, ada lagi soalan sebelum saya tutup this one?
Biasa soalan ada berapa soalan?
5.
Lima soalan. Satu soalan salah satu case tadi. Saya tengok yang case tadi tu panjang juga dia punya satu case tadi tu.
Sebab case tadi tu, okay, so based on case tadi tu, you need to propose lah cara. That's why sebenarnya dalam case tadi tu, kalau you all manage to do well in your video, you all boleh apply dalam on how you can answer the case tadi tu. Step by step tu dah ada kat situ dah sebenarnya.
Okay.
Saya tengok balik. Ya ke 5 eh? Saya rasa 5.
Tu macam apa? Sebab kita orang kan macam saya tak first time kan doktor kan. Nanti kalau final kan ada 4. Macam sebenarnya saya ambil 4 subjek kan. Dia kalau 4 subjek sempat kalau ni eh kita nak buat sekali semua take home kan. Dalam berapa jam?
Cepat. Sempat, jangan risau, sempat. Biasanya exam yang saya buat ni biasanya kalau dalam kampus 3 jam cukup lah. Tu pun lebih dah.
Biasa kalau macam final doktor dia dalam berapa jam doktor akan kasih tempoh masa?
Saya bagi kadang-kadang sampai 5 jam.
Oh, 5 jam. Sebab macam itu kita orang punya midterm 40 jam.
40 jam, amboi. Siapa yang buat soalan exam sampai 40 jam tu? Tak apa, nanti
kita tengok.
Saya tak banyak. 5 soalan tu jawab 3 je.
Oh, jawab 3 lah. Okay lah.
Tak jawab semua.
Soalan pun pening tak nak jawab 5.
Okay, lagi soalan. Ada lagi soalan? Lagi soalan hari ni nak tanya?
Sopar, saya okay.
Mok clear dah eh? Okay, so kat mana kita last time? Kita dah habis ke conflict conflict resolution, conflict management skill? Skill needed in conflict management. Dah ke? Saya rasa untuk kalau untuk kelas mungkin tengoklah, kalau kita akan ada satu lagi kelas yang akhir, lepas tu lagi satu kita dah start dengan presentation dah. Ni kita dah kan? Yang Apple ni kan?
Apple.
Dah sedah ni yang abstract ni.
Apple dah ke?
Itu doktor kan, macam saya tengok macam video kan, waktu yang kelas pertama video memang doktor tak dapat kasih dah kan. Lepas tu saya tengok yang kedua ada video, yang ketiga yang extra kelas tu macam belum ada video lagi kan.
Ya, dia saya tengok balik lah mana saya letak video. Nanti saya tengok balik.
Saya tengok ada satu satu video setakat ni saya ada lah.
Tak apa, slide saya dah clear dah. Baca tengok slide. InsyaAllah baca slide. Okay, tengok slide. InsyaAllah. Okay, so this one dah kot. Ini salah satu teknik eh. Okay, so bila you all nak buat mediation nanti, contohnya eh. So when you are mediator, ask for clarification. So ni daripada, sebab apa case tadi, case abstraction ni lah. Okay, abstraction. Then, you know what, I've attended one training session related to mediation last few days. Okay, in which, okay, every mediator, they should aware about the cultural and the cultural differences between between the conflicting parties. So bila kita buat mediation session ni, so kita kena aware, tambah-tambah kalau let's say session mediation yang kita buat ni melibatkan international business dispute. Okay, maksudnya kalau contoh walaupun kita berada di Malaysia, dan kita tahu in Malaysia we have a lot of MNCs. Okay, multinational companies kan. So kalau let's say the two companies ni, macam contoh Huawei dengan contoh Apple. So dua-dua adalah MNCs. Okay, so kita kena aware bila kita conduct the mediation session ni between the two representative from the organisation ni, so kita kena aware the cultural differences between the two organisation. So kita sebagai mediator, kita kena be more flexible and sensitive related to the cultural issue. Sebab kadang-kadang kalau western countries eh, yes tu not necessarily be a yes. No tu bukan bermaksud no. Ni biasanya kalau yang ni biasanya Asian country. So kalau Asian country, perkataan yes dia kata yeah, not necessarily they mention that they agree. Bila dia kata no, bukan yang bermaksud dia kata dia tak bersetuju. So as a mediator, kita kena address these differences bila kita buat mediation. Okay, so bila kita be a mediator eh, so kita need to make sure that we ask for clarification for the meanings of abstract concept. So kalau let's say party tu kata no, so then kita kena clarify adakah dia betul-betul kata dia tak setuju. Okay, so that everybody has clear interpretation or clear understanding on what been mentioned by the parties. Okay, so for example, if people say they seek a fair and equitable resolution to their conflict, so ask what they consider to be a fair and equitable outcome. So kita kena tanya betul-betul. Kalau contohnya antara dalam kes penceraian eh. Kalau kes penceraian. So kita kena tanya setiap parti ni, setiap kedua-dua pihak, isteri ataupun suami. Okay, kalau dia kata dia nak fair and equitable resolution, so apa maksud dia? Apa yang dia nak? Okay, mungkin daripada dari segi harta sepencarian, okay, hak penjagaan anak. Okay, itulah biasa kalau kes penceraian, biasanya dua itulah yang biasanya dituntut. Okay, harta sepencarian dan juga hak penjagaan anak. So maksudnya kita sebagai mediator, kita kena make sure kita betul-betul faham apa definisi fair and equitable according to the parties. Okay, and then be sure to write it down so you can refer to it at a later time. Okay, and then sometimes people may change definitions, making them a moving target in order to manipulate the negotiation. So that's why kita perlu ada nota kita sendiri, field note kita sendiri. Bila dalam kita buat conduct sesi, sama ada sesi bersama dengan kedua-dua pihak ataupun sesi persendirian dengan setiap pihak, make sure kita letak note kita sendiri. Dan sebelum kita buat note kita tu, dan kita clarify kita tanya to confirm what do they mean. Okay, and then barulah kita jot down. Okay, sebab apa? Sebab bila dalam proses konflik ni, sebab kita tahu konflik ni dia takkan dapat diselesaikan dalam satu tempoh yang singkat, dia akan ada dynamics dia. Dynamic ni maksudnya perubahan interest daripada satu masa kepada satu masa yang lain. Okay, so that's why kita nak avoid supaya tiada manipulation dalam proses negotiation tersebut. Okay, kalau kita ada note ni, so maksudnya kita boleh cakap siap-siap. Okay, and then helping people clarify their concepts in this way will help them to recognize when they have achieved the resolution they seek. Okay. Next one, when you are negotiating a conflict for yourself. Ni maknanya kalau kita negotiate a conflict for ourselves, be sure of your own definition of abstract concept. Write them down. Be as clear and concise as you can be as you work through the negotiations. Okay, ask others for their definition of concept. You already know your definition. So seek out the other party's definition. Okay, so ini pentingnya clarification during the negotiation and mediation process. Ini saya rasa macam dah lah. Dah kan this one kan? Ni je kita tak masuk lagi. Betul tak?
Stress management belum
ada. Stress management belum. Yang tadi Sandi semua ni.
Stress management belum.
Okay, so kita start dengan this one lah hari ni. Okay. So, understanding stress. So, stress ni apa dia? Stress. You all punya definition.
Tekanan.
Memanglah translate dalam bahasa Melayu, tekanan lah jawapan dia. So, what is stress sebenarnya? Stress.
Suatu benda yang di luar apa ni, kehendak kita lah.
Di luar kehendak kita.
Apa yang kita hendak tak dapat, itu kita akan stress lah. Tak menepati kehendak kita. Okay. Stress akan berlaku.
Okay. Lagi? Ada lagi tak definisi lain? Okay, ni definisi buku. Okay, ni definisi buku. So, you all reflect. Stress is defined as any challenge to the balance. To the balance ni means that everybody, dia ada dia punya rutin ataupun comfort zone sendiri. Contohnya kita biasanya comfort zone kita adalah bila kita kata kita bekerja, kita akan bekerja, kita akan kena pergi dekat travel dekat satu tempat kerja dan kita akan ada kita punya table kerja kita sendiri. Itu kita punya comfort zone kita. Itu adalah rutin kita. Tetapi sekiranya berlaku any changes to this routine, itu yang menyebabkan berlakunya tekanan, stress. Betul ke tak? Dia bukan
control the situation lah. Kata.
Apa dia?
Something that you beyond kita punya control lah, comfort zone beyond kita punya control. Something dia punya flow ataupun dia punya result tu is unpredictable lah ataupun tak control lah.
There is uncertainty lah, there is uncertainty in the result. Itu pun boleh jadi. Okay, so they know also known as, thank you Fino, okay, so also known as homeostasis of the body. Okay, homeostasis. Okay, challenges can range from simple change in the weather to traumatizing world news, looming deadlines, pollution, occult, blood pressure change, hunger, feelings of fatigue. Tadi saya nak sebut ni sebenarnya fatigue ni. Inflammation, sleep deprivation, eating processed foods or emotional stress. So anything sebenarnya. So any changes, maksudnya perubahan yang boleh mengganggu kita punya balance. Balance dalam bahasa Melayu apa dia?
Keseimbangan.
Keseimbangan badan kita. So perubahan tu dia boleh menyebabkan berlakunya stress. Okay, so stress can manifest as real life-threatening challenges or hidden stresses like the act of worrying. Ini dia punya manifestation of stress lah ya. Risau, feelings of low self-worth or a faulty immune system that can't mount a strong antibody response. So kalau kita tengok kat sini ya, kesan daripada stress ni kita boleh tengok sama ada secara fizikal dan juga daripada segi emosi tu ya, okey, fizikal, emosi dan juga badan. Immune system kita. Okay, to the brain, anything that challenges the body, homeostasis qualifies as stress, and it doesn't matter whether it is physical, psychological, emotional, real or imagined. Okay, so as long as the brain perceives that your state of balance is being challenged, it counts as stress. Okay, and with that, a physiological stress response is always mounted so that the problem can be solved and you can adapt and ultimately survive. So kalau nak ikutkan kan, okay, stress ni dia macam salah satu kita boleh tengok dalam proses macam mana virus menyerang badan kita. So badan kita di dalam satu bentuk yang stabil. So tiba-tiba ada sesuatu benda asing yang cuba mengganggu sistem tersebut. So proses dia adaptasi daripada badan kita untuk adapt dengan that new benda asing ni, itulah boleh yang boleh menyebabkan berlakunya stres. Okay? Okay, so ini adalah general adaptation system gas. Okay, dalam badan kita. So sekiranya ni dalam badan so saya tak adalah nak sentuh sangat the biological part, but this is just just a rough idea lah . So macam mana badan kita mengadaptasi terhadap satu sistem ataupun mengadaptasi terhadap sesuatu benda yang boleh dikatakan stres. Okay, so first brain becomes more alert. Okay, stress hormones can affect memory and cause neurons to atrophy and die. Okay, dia akan menyebabkan headache, anxiety and depression or disrupted sleep. Okay, and then digestive system slows down. So mouth ulcers or cold sores. Okay, heart rate increase and blood pressure rises. Okay, persistently elevated blood pressure and heart rate can increase potential for blood clotting and risk of stroke or heart attack. So weakening of the heart muscle and symptoms that mimic a heart attack. Okay, and then adrenal glands produce stress hormone. Okay, and then skin problems such as eczema and psoriasis. Okay, and then breathing quickens. Okay, and then increase susceptibility to colds and respiratory infections. Immune system is depressed. Okay, and then digestive system slow down, in which may cause to upset stomach. Okay, reproductive system. Okay, menstrual disorders in women. Importance and premature ejaculation in men. Okay, and then muscle tense, muscular twitch or nervous tics. So inilah faktor dalaman. Okay. Bukan faktor dalaman, kesan dalaman yang berlaku sekiranya seseorang individu berada dalam tekanan. Okay, so inilah dalam badan kita, apa yang berlaku dalam badan kita, in which benda ni kita tak nampak. Yang kita nampak adalah benda-benda yang dah diterjemahkan dalam bentuk action. Okay, kebimbangan, anxiety. Anxiety ni pun hanya individu sahaja yang tahu sama ada dia berada dalam anxiety ataupun tak. Okay. Okay. So stages in gas. So this one takpelah takpelah saya go through lah. So stages in gas, dia akan start dengan first alarm reaction. Okay, in which the body first exposure to the stressors that disrupt its homeostasis start a series of physiological reaction through the automatic and endocrine system. So the endocrine system will produce corticosteroid that will supply the body with resources to fight or flee. Okay, unfortunately, this corticosteroids, payah nak sebut, may weaken the immune system. So ini bila kita ada bila dah start ada sesuatu yang cuba mengganggu badan kita, mengganggu balance badan kita, so badan kita ni akan menghasilkan alarm reaction. Okay, so in which dia akan berlakunya lah penghasilan hormon dan sebagainya dalam badan kita. Okay, and then the second phase, resistant. Okay, so the continued presence of the stressor will activate the stage of resistance, during which the purpose is to sustain life and make necessary adaptations as long as the required fuel and biochemical material are available. Okay, so it is like a gun that keeps firing over and over until it runs out of ammunition, or the shooter's finger cramps to the point it can no longer function. So bila adanya satu benda asing menyerang kita ataupun badan kita, okay, so badan kita akan cuba menghasilkan rintangan. Okay, so dia akan mencuba menyerang. Supaya ini sebenarnya part of the process, salah satu proses adaptasi lah terhadap benda asing ni tadi. Okay, so proses ni dia akan berlaku secara berterusan sehinggalah sumber dalam badan kita tu habis. Dia boleh jadi tenaga, dia boleh jadi chemical dalam badan kita tu sehingga benda tu habis, sumber tu habis. Okay, and then lastly, exhaustion. Stage ketiga adalah exhausted. Okay, if the stressor remains present or is believed to be present, the body will deplete its stored energy to the point that it is no longer capable of mounting any resistance. Mental and physical energy are on empty, exhaustion sets in, permanent damage will result, leading to illness or even death. So dia ada tiga je proses dia. Okay, so stage pertama, which is alarm reaction, second resistant, dan ketiga adalah exhausted. Kalau kita berjaya, maksudnya antibody badan kita berjaya deal with that stressor, kita mungkin tak sampailah dalam stage exhaustion ni. Okay, so ini adalah proses kalau sumber yang ada, sumber dalam dalaman kita ataupun energi kita tak berjaya untuk menangani that stressor, so kita akan sampai the third stage ni. Okay, so the types of stress ni, there are few types. Okay, so the first one in terms of the time frame, so they are the short-term stress and long-term stress. Okay, so short-term stress ni, the kind activated by a sudden threat or danger. For example, you are driving in traffic and another car swerve into your lane, or a situation in which you are asked to make an impromptu presentation in front of a large audience. So ini adalah short-term stress, stress yang berlaku secara ad hoc, secara tiba-tiba. Okay, in which under that circumstances, you will no doubt feel the familiar surge of a stress hormone response activating the fight or flight system. Okay, and then this is usually followed by the activation producing a relaxation response, at which point you begin to calm down and all system return to normal. So short term ni dia boleh berlaku tiba-tiba dan biasanya badan kita akan cepat untuk bertindak balas. Okay, and then long term stress. So this is when the system is turned on a high volume and then remains that way even when the initial danger has passed. Okay, so there is a sort of wear and tear of the body and mind you would expect when a mechanism that was designed for sprint is told that it was to run a marathon. Okay, invariably, parts start to break down and the system fails. This is different sort of marathon that practiced by those who use running as one of many ways to manage their stress, burning off excess energy, distracting them from worries and better conditioning even their bodies. Okay, so long-term stress ni antara satunya boleh jadi disebabkan faktor tekanan kerja. Okay, in which there's certain issue at workplace, so probably you think it for long period of time, so dia akan ada longer effect. Okay, ini antara contoh long-term stress lah . Okay, and then hypertension. Okay, so it means that an excessive amount that overloads the system. Okay, and then, hyperstress. Result from being overloaded or overworked, so it's like being stressed out, okay, and then can trigger a long emotional response. Okay, and then people who are most likely to suffer from hyperstress are working mother who have multitask, juggling between work and family commitment. Okay, and then people who are under constant financial strains, generally people working in fast-paced environment. So ini adalah groups of employees atau people yang have higher tendency to suffer with hyper stress. Okay, bila dia bekerja dalam working environment yang sentiasa berubah, okay, ada masalah kewangan ataupun masalah keluarga. Okay, and then those who have multitask, that's those who work in multitask environment yang terpaksa ada multiple roles at one time. Okay, ni sekarang ni kalau during COVID-19 ni, inilah salah satu tendensi dia. Okay, hyper stress. In which bila kita bekerja di rumah, anak-anak tidak boleh dihantar ke nursery. Okay, and then kita terpaksa bekerja and then pada masa yang sama need to apply multiple roles with at the same time. Okay? Inilah sebab di zaman COVID ni dia banyak benda yang berubah. Okay, berubah secara mendadak. Dia awal-awal dulu dia boleh dikira sebagai short term stress. Sebab dalam masa dekat kan. But now dia boleh jadi sebagai long term stress. In which inilah dia akan mengganggu kita ni. Hyper stress. Okay?
Nampak rasa lah doktor. Bila ada baby ni, bila apa buat kerja koma, aduh. Dengan baby pun panjat kan.
Betul. Sebenarnya baby tu pun dia stress, anak-anak pun stress, kita pun stress. So everybody sebenarnya struggling. That's why saya kata tadi awal-awal kelas tadi, everybody are struggling right now. Kalau dulu, kalau let's say kalau kita bekerja sebab work from home previously, apa tu situasi bekerja daripada rumah sebelum ni, kita boleh hantar anak-anak ke nursery, ke tempat penjagaan, dan kita boleh berada di rumah dan bekerja sendiri di rumah. Itu saya rasa role dia adalah sangat sikit lah in which kita just boleh fokus dekat bekerja. But now dengan pandemic situation ni, kita bekerja di rumah, yes, somehow it sounds good for someone that probably dah lama rasa macam dah malas nak pergi office. It sounds good. But bila ada anak-anak, okay, we need to do the multiple roles at one point. Kena ada contohnya ada kita kena bekerja pada masa yang sama, anak-anak tak boleh dihantar ke nursery dan kita kena jaga anak lagi.
Okay. Betul lagi satu doktor, saya nampak sebab macam terutamanya macam wife saya lah, dia cikgu kan. Cikgu saya nampak kadang apa ni punya apa ni result dia still masih sama lagi kan. Apa yang perlu dibuat waktu time bekerja sama juga apa dia perlu buat dekat rumah kan. So susah lah kat situ kan. So saya pula bila itu saya terpaksa bantu jugalah wife kan. Bila dia buat apa kerja kan.
Betul. Sebab dia adjustment lah. The adjustment tu dia sepatutnya bukan sahaja daripada pihak pekerja. Somehow the organisation pun need to think the way that can is the burden of their employee. So benda ni sebenarnya akan membantu work-life balance untuk setiap employee. The adjustment tu. Tapi sebab the changes ni it's too immediate, terlalu singkat. So sampai ada organisasi sampai sangat struggle untuk come up with new procedures. Sebab bila bekerja daripada rumah, okay, the organisation need to think of their PNC. Private and confidential document. Sebab bila pekerja tak boleh dibenarkan datang ke tempat kerja, ada dokumen yang sepatutnya tak boleh dibawa keluar daripada organisasi, in which terpaksa juga dibawa keluar. So organisasi somehow pun dah berada dalam keadaan yang sangat genting sebab dia kena come out dengan a very quick or a recent procedure that may follow the SOP. Dan pada masa yang sama dia punya rules and regulation within the organisation. Okay, so memang sangat struggle. Okay, so next one is hypostress. So hypostress ni related to not enough to keep the body tuned and ready for action. Okay, and then experienced by a person who is constantly bored. Ini berlaku juga pada orang yang terlalu bosan. Okay, ni orang tak ada kerja ni tak ada stress ke? Okay, so dia ada hypostress. Kalau hypostress ni orang yang terlalu sibuk. Boleh kata terlalu sibuk lah. Hypostress ni orang yang tak sibuk. Okay, so someone in an unchallenging job such as factory worker performing the same task over and over again. Ni kalau kita bekerja dalam organisasi, kalau kita ada staff yang involved dalam routine work. Dan routine itu routine sama sahaja. Dia sebenarnya dia boleh mengalami hypostress. Okay, and then the effect of hypostress is feeling of restlessness and lack of motivation. So salah satu cara kita nak tengok orang yang dah tak ada motivation ni sebenarnya adalah bila kita tengok cara dia buat kerja tu, dia akan ulang mistake yang sama. Okay, dia tak ada dah sense of to improve dia way of doing work. Dia dah tak ada cara dah. Dia memang ikut saja walaupun dia tahu cara yang dia buat tu adalah salah. So dia akan buat saja. Okay. And then next one, distress. Okay, so usually associate with the word stress. So sebenarnya stress yang kita selalu sebut tu adalah merujuk kepada distress ni. Okay, so destructive and harmful salt, that means rubble, especially if it moves beyond acute arousal to chronic condition. It occurs when our ability to cope with stressors is insufficient. Okay, and then it causes anxiety and confusion and decrease your performance in daily activities. And then associated with stressful events that occur unexpectedly. Okay, even when good news strike too suddenly, it may shock the recipient and cause stress. Okay, and then this stress also may occur when you try to manage too many things simultaneously and lose control of the situation. So this stress ni dia adalah merujuk kepada stress yang kita kata stress-stress tu. Okay, so distress ni berlaku apabila kita tidak lagi boleh menangani sesuatu bendasing yang berlaku dalam hidup kita ni. Satu cabaran tu kita rasa kita dah tak boleh nak berdepan lagi. Itulah stage di mana kita sebenarnya menghadapi tekanan. Okay, so tekanan ni selagi kita rasa kita boleh deal with that situation, itu bukan considered sebagai tekanan lagi sebenarnya. Maksudnya dia still considered to be tekanan positif lah. This one ni, distress ni considered to be destructive stress. Okay. So next one is new stress, which is rather neutral, has little impact or lasting effect, has little measurable effect on your life, and then you might find yourself in a performance situation in which the added presence of an audience is below your radar because you are concentrating so hard on your job. Okay. Next one, you stress. Banyak. Okay, so next one, kind of stress that inspire or motivates you to go beyond present levels of functioning. Okay, this is what happens with the so-called clutch hitter, is a hitter in baseball, or the pressure player in other sports. So the presence of an audience combined with high stakes on the line motivates the athlete to unparalleled performance. Okay, so the same could be true for artists, actors, writers and others who are required to perform under pressure. Okay, it stimulates the system of the body to function at peak levels. This can even be the case for the kind of growth that can take place for some people after a crisis or trauma. So, kalau kita rasa yang kita boleh deal lagi dengan stress tu, sebenarnya itu adalah eustress. Okay? Okay, so ini adalah dia punya comparison performance according to the level of stress. Okay, so kalau stress kita low, dia akan considered to be hypostress. Medium and low ni tendency for hypostress. Okay, kalau medium ni, peak ni, you stress. Okay, and then from medium to high ni, dia tend to hypostress or distress. Okay, so dia ada 4 level kat sini. Okay, so basically stress ni kita nak juga ada tapi dekat medium level. Dekat medium level ni barulah individual or employee performance tu tend to be at the peak level, optimal level. Okay. Ni faham macam mana nak baca graf ni? Okay, so ni pun samalah sama macam graf tadi. Okay, kalau tak cukup tekanan pun dia akan jadi border, kebosanan. Okay, right amount of pressure, dia akan jadi high motivation and peak performance. Kalau terlalu banyak, dia akan menyebabkan fatigue. Fatigue ni keletihan lah. Keletihan, exhaustion ataupun ill health. Ataupun lastly, breakdown. Okay, breakdown ni memang badan kita dah tak mampu berfungsi lagi ni, breakdown ni. Okay, sama lah. Okay, so sources of stress. So, there are three. Okay, external sources, internal sources, and then the interaction of internal and external sources. So stress ni can be manifest as a physical sensation, pounding heart, sama ada degupan jantung kita kuat, a psychological experience, feeling of panic, for example, as well as biochemical and other processes. So biochemical ni dia sedikit bahayalah sebab kita tak boleh nampak pounding heart ataupun sakit kepala, kita boleh rasa lagi. Okay, migraine, okay. And then physical stress occurs when the human body is affected by sleep deprivation, overworking, excessive physical exertion, physical injury or trauma, viral or bacterial infections, okay, inflammation, physical disease or chronic pain. It is under such circumstances that the body begins to lose functioning and break down. Okay, and then psychological stress is often used synonymously with mental stress or emotional stress. So ini yang currently been discussed a lot lah. mental issue ni. Memang sekarang ni banyak dibincangkan sebab the rate is very high right now. Okay, related to how we interpret the events in our life, they are determined by our values, belief, attitudes and philosophies of life. Okay, so bila macam saya kata tadi, bila berlakunya perubahan dari segi struktur environment kita bekerja, okay, pada masa yang sama dia akan challenge our values, belief, attitude and so on. So ni akan challenge values and belief ni, dia akan challenge sebenarnya bila kita bekerja kat rumah ni, sebenarnya dia akan challenge dia yang mana lagi penting, family or work. Okay, so sama sebelum ni kita boleh dividekan isu keluarga dengan bekerja ni sebab kita ada dua tempat berbeza untuk kita melakukan tanggungjawab tersebut. Okay, bila bekerja kita ada di kita ada workplace. Bila kita when it is related to family issue, then kita berada di rumah. Kita masih lagi ada sense of on how we can divide these two things. Okay, tapi bila kita terpaksa melakukan kedua-dua kerja pada masa yang sama di tempat yang sama, so the conflict may arise. Okay, dia akan lagi the tendency to have the conflict ni dia akan jadi lagi tinggi lah. Okay. Okay, so given the same situation, different people may react very differently due to their outlook on life. Okay, so emotional reactions such as anger, fear, low self-esteem and hostility are also influenced by our belief. So sekarang ni bila kita start bekerja daripada rumah ni, our belief, apa yang paling penting dekat hidup kita ni, inilah akan mempengaruhi level of stress in our life. Okay, dia akan, kalau kita rasa kita ni adalah jenis yang work oriented, memang lebih utamakan kerja, so probably as much as possible kita akan rasa stress. So sekiranya tengah kerja tu kita diganggu oleh ahli keluarga. Tapi kalau kita ni jenis yang family oriented, so probably we do not feel that stress. Kalau tiba-tiba kita tengah meeting, anak-anak buka pintu, kita tak rasa stress sangat. Kalau kita ni jenis our values is prone towards family. So sekarang ni kita kena adjust ourselves lah, which one that is more important to you. Okay. And then the good news is that you can change your thoughts, thereby changing your reaction to the events in your life. So maksudnya kat sini, pemikiran apa yang kita rasa penting dekat kita tu sebenarnya kita boleh ubah. So level of stress yang kita ada tu sebenarnya kita boleh ubah depending on how we look at our belief, we revise again our belief and values ni. Kita tengok balik. Okay. The bad news is that some thought patterns have been deeply ingrained in your mind and then require a consistent effort to be modified. Ini kalau let's say I'm not biased, just give the example. For example, men lah. For example, men, because their orientation is because they believe that they should be the breadwinner for the family. Bila kita kata dia breadwinner for the family, so means that they hold a huge responsibility to make sure that he fulfill the needs of their family. Okay, so dia rasa dia ada that responsibility. So probably in this situation lah, dia akan rasa terganggu sekiranya family mengganggu ada interruption in family when during the working hours. Okay, next example. Okay, next one, the fourth stage of stress management and prevention. So the first stage is life situation or chronic stressors, in which the stress prevention kita boleh apply lah. And then perception and evaluation, stress response and consequences. Exhaustive. Okay, tak apa, yang empat level ni saya rasa you all boleh tengok nanti. InsyaAllah. Okay. Okay, and then the principle of stress prevention and management, there are five principle. Okay, the first one, prevention is more effective than management. Okay, so kalau boleh bila kita berdepan dengan stress ni, dia lebih baik kalau kita cuba prevent. Okay, prevention is better than management. So management ni sebab bila dah berlaku dan barulah kita nak manage. Okay, and then small changes can lead to big effect. Okay, and then don't count on a magic solution for solving all your stress problem. Okay, and then tailor a program to your own schedule and means, and then develop a comprehensive plan for stress prevention and management. Okay. Any questions so far related to stress management ni? Any question before we proceed with the anger management?
Okay.
No, doktor.
Senang je sebab ni kita boleh reflect kat diri kita balik je. Cuma there is one tips lah eh. There is one tip related to overall lah, related to how we can work better while working from home ni. Somehow again macam when the point is related to tailor a program to your own schedule and means ni. So maksudnya macam saya kata tadi, kita revise balik values kita, our self values and principle, which one is more important to us when we work from home. Okay, sebab bila kita bekerja kat rumah ni, dia sangat genting sebab dia akan mudah menyebabkan kita stres. Sebenarnya stres tu berlaku sebab priority yang kita letakkan dalam diri kita sendiri. So probably eh, this one eh, based on a short research that I conducted earlier of the COVID-19 period, macam mana bila ramai pekerja terpaksa berada bekerja daripada rumah. So one of the way that you that can reduce the level of stress, probably you pretend to work as usual. Salah satu caranya adalah bila bangun pagi tu, pretend macam kita seolah-olah nak pergi bekerja mengikut rutin kerja yang sama. Bangun pagi, iron baju, pakai baju smart-smart macam biasa. Okay, itu salah satu cara untuk kita go through the situation. Okay, iron baju, pakai smart-smart macam biasa dan follow the working hours as usual. Supaya kita rasa kita bekerja macam biasa. Okay. Dan ini based on research yang sebenarnya saya follow that research so that saya apply. Sebab I feel the same thing during the earlier COVID-19 hari tu. Saya rasa benda tu sangat mengganggu saya punya rutin. So then I conduct one study among my clique and so on to get their response. So feedback dia orang adalah untuk reducekan that level of stress, adalah itu cara dia. Okay, dia buat, they follow the similar routine. Okay, they just try to tak memikirkan yang bekerja dulu kat office, sekarang kat rumah. Dia tak ambil sangat waktu dan dia make sure that dia ada proper working arrangement dekat rumah. Ada table, ada computer. Okay, itu cara yang dia buat untuk reduce the stress.
Okay doktor, baru nak tanya kan? Macam yang ayat dia apa, don't count on a magic solution for solving all your stress problem ni, maksud dia apa?
Maksudnya dia satu kaedah, bila kita nak selesaikan sesuatu konflik tu, kita tak boleh just rely on one technique. Maksudnya we need to be very flexible in adapting to the situation. Kita tak boleh hanya rely satu saja. Maksudnya kat sini sebenarnya dia berkait semualah. Bila kita rasa kerja kita lagi penting daripada family, dia akan isu dia kat sinilah. So maksudnya flexibility tu is required lah. Meaning that when at this time we need to adjust ourselves that both family and work are important, equally important. Okay? Oh, okay. So kita kena adjust. Maksudnya point kat sini dia saling berkait. So dia tak boleh satunya. You kena faham, contohnya kalau kita dengan pasangan kita kat rumah kan, you kena faham ni masa saya bekerja. Okay, anak-anak you jaga. Kalau if let's say you kita punya spouse adalah memang suri rumah, memang sudah masa sepenuh masa, then probably we can have that schedule lah. Okay, this time I'm working. Okay, but if let's say both couple are working, okay, so then we need to make our arrangement lah. Okay, for example, kalau kita kena ada jadual kita sendiri. So, dua jam ni saya bekerja, awak jaga anak. Contoh. So, nanti awak jaga anak ni maksudnya help them in PDP ke. Okay, and then next 2 hours, then we shift. Itu maksudnya kita kena ada our own arrangement with our family members lah. Macam mana untuk nak keluar pergi cari bahan mentah and so on. Itu salah satu arrangement that we need to do with our family members while working from home. Dia lain. Dia sama macam bila kita bekerja dekat office. Dulu kita team members kita adalah office mate. Tapi bila kita bekerja daripada rumah, office kita berubah. In which kita punya team members adalah kita punya family members. So we need to do a new arrangement in our work. Okay?
Okay.
Sebab saya pun practice benda yang sama. Okay, arrangement dia dah berbeza. So saya kena schedule balik, okay, dengan family members. Ini masa saya bekerja, ini masa you bekerja. Okay? Okay, next one is anger management. So anger management, according to the dictionary, it is referring to the strong feeling of displeasure or hostility. Okay, or according to Charles Spielberger. Okay, an emotional state that varies in intensity from mild irritation to intense fury and rage. Okay, and then by Benjamin Franklin. Next tu, tu gambar apa tu Benjamin Franklin. Okay, anger is never without a reason but seldom with a good one. So anger ni it is related to feeling lah, feeling. Okay, dan kalau ikut apa tu Benjamin ni, dia kata kemarahan ni dia adalah dia takkan berlaku tanpa alasan, dan biasanya alasan tersebut adalah alasan yang memang betul-betul alasan yang reasonable untuk kita marah. Okay. Okay, so human interaction style. So there are three style. Okay, when it is related to anger. Okay, so aggressive, assertive, and submissive. Okay, so assertive, aggressive related to me first attitude. Okay, and then concern with own well-being. Okay, so become pushy, hotheads, or bullies. Ini dia punya apa tu kriteria lah. Okay. What is in their mind or mind state of aggressive people? Okay. Dalam apa dalaman yang difikirkan? My way or the highway? Okay, my way is the best way. Get them before they get you. Okay, the best defense is an offense. How you play doesn't count, only that you win. Okay, never give a sucker an even break. Okay, don't bother thinking or talking things over. Just do what you have to do. So ini untuk orang agresif. Okay, next one. How do aggressive people act? Okay, these people intentionally attack, take advantage of, humiliate, hurt and put other people down. They are usually outraged if anyone treats them the same way. Sometimes they act covertly like gossiping or starting ugly rumors. If someone behave offensively toward them, they immediately counterattack. They jump to conclusion and react to situations based on assumptions that are often not correct. They surround themselves with people they can easily control. Okay, ni kita reflect diri kita masing-masing lah. So second one is submissive. So submissive ni feelings insecure and tend to show it. Afraid to stand up for themselves and frequently allow other people take advantage of them. Put themselves down, apologize when they should be the one apologized to, and constantly seek the approval of others. Okay. And then what is in their mind? Okay, I always get these things wrong. Other people are more important than me. I must never cause anyone to be disappointed or disapprove of me. I should never say no to anyone for any reason. I should never give anyone a stomach or headache except myself. I don't have the right to ask questions about situations I don't understand. Okay. Then how do submissive people act? Submissive people permit others to hurt, humiliate or take advantage of them. Okay, they frequently grovel and make negative statements about themselves. If someone behaves offensively toward them, they immediately give in and give way. They rarely speak up with their opinion or ask questions about situations they don't understand. They allow themselves to be chosen as companions by people who easily control them. Okay, so inferior lah eh? Inferior, the feeling of inferior, submissive. Okay, next one is assertive, which is don't resort to the tactics of aggressive people, but they are not wimps. Okay, stand up for themselves while remaining cool and calm. They are respectful but direct about their feelings, needs and desires. They are confident and they know their rights. Okay, they know and respect the rights of others as well. Okay, and then what is in their mind? I know that all individuals are equally important, including me. I know how I feel, what I need and what I want. I can state my feelings, needs and wants to other people when I choose to. I have the right to ask for what I want or need, and other people have the right to say yes or no. I can't complain if I don't get what I wanted, but I didn't ask for it. Okay, other people have an equal right to ask for what they want or need, and I have the right to say yes or no. If I don't understand a situation, I can ask questions to find out what I need to know. Okay, and then next, last one, how do assertive people act? They express themselves openly and honestly to communicate their feelings, wants and needs without demanding them. Show respect for the feelings, wants and needs of others. Understand that each individual has a point of view. If someone's behavior toward them is offensive, they ask what the problem is without attacking back or becoming defensive. When they don't understand what's going on, they ask questions. They select companions who are also assertive. So kalau boleh, dalam situasi sekarang ni, be more assertive than aggressive or submissive. Okay, we try to be considerate. Try to apply the assertive. Okay, so next one. Okay, so which style lead to anger management? So based on that one tadi, which style among the three, submissive, aggressive and assertive, that lead to anger management? Which one?
Aggressive
lagi bagus.
Assertive,
so you just follow the criteria. So why not we try to adjust ourselves to the assertive style instead of aggressive or submissive. Okay, so submissive ni biasanya orang yang inferior lah. Okay, aggressive ni yang superior. Superior, inferior. So kalau boleh kita nak duduk tengah-tengah, assertive.
Tengah-tengah.
Okay, ni lah. Appropriate anger ni tak faham ni. Okay, so this one probably a few strategies lah that we can deal with anger. The first one, the use of I message. Active listening, compromising, postponing, apologizing and expressing regret and problem solving. Ini adalah beberapa teknik yang kita boleh guna pakai. Dan di teknik ni you all boleh apply sama ada dalam proses negotiation ataupun mediation juga. Okay, so the first one is I message. Okay, why is it that some people have lots of friends and rarely get into fights with anyone? Tengok tak? Kenapa ada setengah orang tu dia ramai kawan? Dan susah untuk gaduh. Okay, it isn't because they never become provoked. Sebab apa? Okay, and then sometimes they do find themselves in conflict, and when it happens, they usually have a way of settling things easily and quickly with the other person so that they can remain on good terms with each other. Okay, so these people aren't magic. They just have an assertive skill which give them power, which is the use I message. I message. Okay. Okay, so with an I message, you can express your own concerns. In order to express them, you have to be honest with yourself and recognize what your concerns are. When the listener hears your I message, she knows she has done something you object to or feel bad about. Okay, so by delivering an I message, you can make a strong assertive statement without making the listener feel blame, which no one's like, even when guilty. This is a clear way to tell people how you feel and what you want and need from them without causing them to want to get even. Okay, so I message means that saya ada contoh kot. Sekejap eh. Saya ada aktiviti ni. Sekejap.
Message tu doktor ada macam kita message ke ataupun kita bagi tahu apa yang kita kehendak kita ke?
Kita bagi tahu apa kehendak kita. I message bukan message. Sekejap. Saya share ni. Kan saya punya lecture note on iMessage ya. Kejap eh. mana pula saya punya ni? Okay, this one contoh ya. Okay, ni. This is the example. Okay, so imagine you are work, you are at work and have come late several times. Okay, so now the head of department is talking with you about it. Read that, read what the HOD says and then write your reaction. Contoh eh. Dia bagi macam ni. So you all you selalu datang lambat bekerja. Sorry, datang have come late several times. Berapa kali datang lambat. Okay, so HOD kita kata, you fail to turn up on time again. So probably because you didn't care enough to get ready and leave on time. So you could get here before 8 a.m. You would better watch that tardiness habit and stop being so flaky. Okay, in the first statement yang you all buat. So what do you think? What will you feel if your boss say like this? Anybody?
More down lah. More down satu. Yang paling hardcore kalau head of department ni dikasih surat penjelasan.
Okay. So maksudnya kalau point dekat sini, kalau kita diberi ayat ni, kita akan rasa down and demotivated. Okay. So now, kita tengok ayat kedua. Okay. Okay, I'm feeling concerned that you weren't here again on time today because you missed things. I regret it because it will influence your overall performance evaluation, which set the tone for the session. I'm sure hoping you will be here before 8 a.m. next time. So this is, what do you feel now? If your boss, if your HOD says this to you? Rasa? Siapa Fino?
Rasa sedih.
Then we'll feel guilty, then we'll feel motivated to improve it in the future. Am I correct?
Yes.
So inilah dia I message. Okay, you portray your own true feeling. Okay, and then the message that you give is actually for to motivate others. Okay, to improve better in the future. Because sometimes, kalau kita bagi ayat ni, we do not express our true feeling pun. Okay, I message ni, we give the message that truly represent what we want. Kenapa why we want our employee to be to arrive on time? Kenapa? Kenapa at the first place? Kenapa kita nak pekerja kita datang betul-betul pukul 8? Betul-betul kalau pukul 8 mesti pukul 8. Kenapa? Because it's related to their performance. When it is related to their performance, it is related to organizational performance.
Discipline is big.
So why discipline at first place? Because we believe.
Tapi kan, doktor kan, macam kita contohlah, macam kita yang ada anak kecil ni kan. Kadang-kadang kita bukan tak nak datang cepat. Kadang kita, contoh macam saya sendirilah. Saya sendiri macam kadang pernah juga bos cakap macam itu kan. Tapi saya explain jugalah, kadang kita bukan tak nak pergi awal pukul 8. Masalahnya macam saya pun bangun awal kan, pukul lebih situ, pukul 5 lebih kan. Tapi macam kita nak uruskan anak lagi, nak hantar baby ke pengasuh, duduk pula rumah apartment, lift gulis semua. Lepas tu bila kita on the way pula, kadang yalah bukannya
there's a lot of unexpected
banyak aku kata halangan lah. Itu yang lepas tu layar tu kadang kita pergi lambat pun bukan kita terus buat kerja. Kadang kita tengok ada orang pergi awal pukul 8 ataupun pukul 7.30, pukul 6, 6.30. Tapi tengok mereka relax, tak ada pun buat kerja. Kadang borak-borak. Macam kita datang lambat tapi kita terus buat kerja. Kadang performance ni bagi saya datang awal ke datang lambat, yang penting you do your job is be okay lah. Bukannya dari segi timing tu kan. Dapat saya lah.
Okay, tak boleh macam tu. Okay. Okay, so dia macam ni. Okay, because somehow dia depends kepada mungkin those who have working experience may correct me lah eh. So because when we work, okay, so we, somehow we have the time schedule lah. But in terms of the scheduling, perhaps if those who have at management level, so they have some flexibility lah. Okay, but this one in terms of kita dalam konteks sekarang adalah konteks if you are a leader within the organisation. Contohnya kalau contoh Syafian ada anak buah, contohnya kalau kita sebagai anak buah ni kadang-kadang susahlah juga. Tapi sekarang ni because I'm train you to be a leader in the future. Kan bila kita maksudnya kalau sekarang ni contoh Syafian tak puas hati dengan apa yang berlaku dekat tempat kerja Syafian, so probably one day if you are at that position, so there's something that you need to do lah. Okay, maksudnya benda tu. Okay, so benda yang ada sekarang ni probably saya pun tak boleh nak ubah. Okay, but in the future, if let's say you are at that position, this is actually what we can do. Okay, because we know that sometimes as a leader within organisation, kita pun ada dilema. So between the humanity and then also between the humanity part and as well as the responsibility within the organisation that we have. Kan bila kita bekerja, so kita ada tanggungjawab. We need to make sure that bila kita bekerja based on the salary that we receive, we do the appropriate work that we need to do. Kan we need to make sure that the work being completed at the given time. Contohnya we achieve certain organizational goal. Kita ada that responsibility. So when you become the manager or leader within the organisation one day, so that these are the things that you may look through lah. Okay, to make some adjustment within your organisation. Okay, so ini sebab bila kita bekerja, kita nak make sure yang regardless of the environment that our employee face, so we need to make sure that our employees remain motivated. So bila kita guna iMessage ni, ini adalah salah satu sebenarnya yang kita change the way our employees feel. Okay, dia bukan sahaja melalui prosedur organisasi yang boleh menyebabkan employee kita rasa suka bekerja, but sometimes the way we interact with them. Okay, bila diorang rasa they've been appreciated, ada pihak atasan yang rasa concern pasal dia. You just imagine lah Syafian, if let's say your boss say this to you, kan contohnya, dan you all rasa, kita rasa lagi motivated untuk buat kerja, kan, instead of kalau kita rasa yang atas ni, betul tak? So saya pun faham lah dan situasi tu saya faham, tapi kalau let's say one day you have the subordinate, so this is what we can do, this is what the change that probably we can apply within our organisation. Okay.
Tapi doktor, I believe that di organisation juga kena tengok jugalah which organisation. Kalau macam Safiannya organisation, tak bolehlah pakai the second one, kena pakai the first one.
Si tengok, so ada this is the options lah the option. So but itulah referring to the situation to me. So but because this one the second statement, the iMessage ni, because if you want to motivate the employees more, okay, so maksudnya kita tak nak rasa dia demotivated bila buat kerja. Okay, but you just imagine that if let's say you are at the place of this employee yang datang lambat ni. Contoh kalau
doktor, macam pendapat saya lah. Macam apa benda ni pun dia based on situasi juga sebenarnya kan. Kalau contoh macam kerja yang tak memerlukan apa-apa macam akurasi lah, maksud dia memerlukan yang timing yang concern, macam contoh dari segi pejabat, dari segi kerja yang kita kata benda tu bukannya you mesti kena pukul 8 start boleh you siapkan kerja sampai pukul 5, maksud dia complete tu lah. Nah, itu kalau macam bentuk situ, saya rasa iMessage tu sesuai lah sebab benda tu bukan yang urgent yang you mesti siapkan dalam tempoh masa tertentu. Tapi kalau macam contoh macam Pino cakap, macam contoh macam saya policeman kan, okay. Contoh macam operasi. Macam kita nak buat satu operasi ataupun kita buat macam contoh sekatan jalan lah, sekatan jalan raya. Kalau kata pukul 8, maksud dia saya rasa yang pertama tu kita kena guna ayat yang tu lah. Sebab dia kalau kita berlapis-lapis susah juga, sebab kita pukul 8 kita nak on sharp untuk terus buat kerja kan. Itu kalau semua apa ni tak datang pada tepat pada masa, susahlah untuk kita buat contoh macam COVID-19 ni yang kita buat sekatan jalan kan. Maksud dia kita kena ikut situasi jugalah.
Betul.
Apa pendapat saya lah.
Betul. Betul lah tu. Dia tengok situasi. Cuma dia apply kebalik kepada the setting of the working environment lah. Okay. Kalau biasanya kalau yang this one ni dia bukan tak boleh pakai. Okay. Sebab kita somehow ayat dia lebih kurang sama. Okay, kalau you all tengok cuma lebih kurang sama ayat dia. Sebenarnya dia nak cakap yang dua ni yang still datang lambat pukul 8 tu still salah. Cuma the way we portray our message tu. Maksudnya kalau kat sini, okay, dia marah, dia more kepada because you didn't care enough to get ready and leave. So ni dia more kepada blaming. Okay, macam yang first ni dia more kepada blaming. Kalau you perasan dua-dua ayat ni dia sama. Dia nak still nak kata yang datang lambat lebih daripada 28 tu salah. Okay, but the way they portray the information, the way they portray the message. Macam kat this one ni dia more kepada menyalahkan. We blame. Okay, kan? But the second one ni, kita portray kenapa kita nak dia datang pukul 8. Sebab apa? Sebab it is related to your overall performance evaluation. We concern about their career growth. Sebab tu kita nak dia datang pukul 8. So meaning that we come up with proper clarification. So why you are required to come at 8 a.m. Ini kontak dia sama. Faham tak? Mesejnya still. Kalau datang pukul lambat tu salah. Tapi kat sini dia show concern of the employee. Macam this one, it more on blaming. Blame the employee. Faham tak? Dia cara kita menyampaikan mesej. Datang pukul 8 lambat pukul 8 tu still salah. Tapi caranya. Okay? Faham eh? I message ni?
Okay, faham.
Okay. Next one. Okay, so next one adalah active listening. Okay, so have you noticed how you feel when you are upset about something and the other person or people involved won't listen? Bila kita bercakap.
Tak nampak.
Yeah. Huh? Tak nampak eh? Oh, tak nampak. Okay, this is the one. Okay, and then okay, so for example kalau kita bercakap dan kita perasan orang yang kita sedang bercakap tu tak mendengar. Okay, tak mendengar apa yang kita cakap. So we feel frustrated. Okay, so the opposite is also true. One of the best way to settle a tense situation with someone is to listen. Okay, and then just stop talking and start listening to what other people say. Okay, so you have to be respectful, sincere and silent no matter how much you want to say something. So this one, active listening ni regardless of what position we are at. Sama ada we are at the managerial level, subordinate level, as a mother, as a father. So why not we listen more to our subordinate? Okay, when you use this strategy, you lean forward, look into the person's eyes and really try to understand him, especially his feelings and opinion. Okay, just keep listening and finally he will be ready to listen to you. Okay, but it will be a while to be very, very patient. Okay, you may think that this strategy weakens your position, but guess again, it strengthens you and it works like a charm. So kita cuba lebih mencerap. Okay, we apply active listening when we deal with our difficult employees. Kalau kita ada pekerja yang memang susah nak handle ni, why not we listen more to what they want to say? Okay, next one is compromising. Okay, let's say an impossible situation has presented itself and you and another person both want the same thing at the same time. Contohnya, kalau kat tempat kerja kadang-kadang isu berebut kerusi je boleh jadi isu besar. Berebut kerusi hidrolik tu. Okay, so you suggest a compromise that allows each of you to get some of it. So you could share something like a sandwich or take turns using something like a computer. Contoh kalau berebut kerusi tadi, mungkin minggu ni you guna, next week I guna. So we come up with that arrangement so that the problem can be settled. Kita ada compromise. Okay, kalau contohnya berebut motosikal rondaan tu, Sufian. Syafian. Contoh. But ada yang baru. Contohnya ada yang baru sampai. Berebut nak pakai yang baru. Contohnya this week you pakai. Next week I pakai. Okay, contoh berebut mesin kira duit. Contohnya Vino. Contoh. Kan? That's the example. This is one of the recommendation that we can apply lah. Okay, so the way you use this strategy is to offer to give up something if the other person will do the same. Okay, and then the key is that you make the offer and you show that you will give up your part first. This almost always causes the other person to wait to want to cooperate. Okay, and then if the thing you both want can't be divided, or if the other person refuse to compromise, suggest flipping a coin. So why not? Right? It looks childish, but it solves the potential big issues. Okay. And then postponing. Next one, postponing. Have you ever noticed how fights usually happen when one or both people are in a bad mood, hungry or tired? Okay. And then the strategy of postponing is exactly that. You suggest that you put off discussing the matter and get back to it later. Dia macam avoidance, but you will discuss regarding the conflict later on after you are in good shape. Maksudnya kadang-kadang bila kita ada pertengkaran tu, sometimes because you are hungry. Okay, then you try to postpone for a while after you feeling your stomach. Okay, and then you get back to the issue again. Okay, so for example, look kalau I've had a long day and I feel lousy. Okay, could we get back to this tomorrow? Okay, or I've got an idea. Let's go eat and talk about this afterward. I'm so stuffed, I can think straight. So what about you? Okay, do be sure to get back with her later at the agreed upon time and then start out with active listening. Okay, ni maksudnya postponing. Dia macam avoidance, tapi avoidance tu dia avoid the situation for long period. But this postpone until you are in good shape or ready to discuss about the issue. Okay. Next one, apologizing or expressing regret. Okay, sometimes a sincere apology and admitting your mistake is the best strategy when you have actually offended someone and they have become angry as anyone would. Okay, and then but there are times when you didn't say or do exactly what they think you say or did. Okay, let's suppose you say something and someone takes it in the wrong way. Tell the person to as soon as you realize he or she is hurt or angry. Okay, then have the strength to say you are sorry and explain that you never meant to cause bad feelings. Okay, accidents are another example. You may have caused an accident somehow, but you never intended anyone to get hurt. Okay, that's when you might prefer to express regret. You could say it's terrible that it happened. I don't blame you for being mad, or I'm sorry it happened. I didn't do it on purpose. Okay, when other people know you feel regret and that you care about them, it makes a huge difference. Okay, so why not? Bila kita ada contohnya terlanggar kereta orang, the first thing that we need to do, just ask for sorry. Just seek for apologize. Okay, itu akan menyebabkan banyak problem boleh disettlekan. Sama ada dekat situ je pun. Okay, instead of we bring it to court ataupun we call the police and someone got summon. Right, summon 300. Sebab benda boleh diselesaikan kat situ. Okay, next one is problem solving. Okay, then sometimes things can get complicated between you and another person. So with the strategy of problem solving, you use as many of the other strategies as you can, especially active through listening, iMessage and calm and respectful voice. Okay, if you don't understand the other person, don't interrupt. When he finish talking, explain that you don't understand and ask question, then listen some more. Okay, next, see if you can define the problem without any blaming. Take the attitude that the two of you are against the problem, not against each other. Okay, means that we focus on problem, not focusing on individual characteristic. This one you need to very skillful in dividing between the issues and the people. Okay, kita nak selesaikan isu, masalah, bukan nak selesaikan manusia ni. Okay, so suggest brainstorming ideas for solution to the problem together and then agree on one or more that seem to make the most sense. If you can agree on a solution, postpone deciding until later after each of you has had a chance to come down and think about it some more. So that skill yang saya present tadi, you all boleh pakai pada masa yang sama. I message, problem solving, apologizing, postponing, ni kita boleh apply pada pada situasi yang sama. If you think that you are not yet ready to resolve the issue, then postpone. Okay? Ni tak ada apa lah. Ni tak ada apa lah.
Okay, doktor. Saya juga nak inform sikit lah.
Yeah.
Okay, sekarang kan kita ada banyak yang PR pasal COVID-19 kan?
Yes.
Okay, so sebagai macam saya pun pernah jadi pegawai incas lah dekat sekatan jalan ni. Mm-hmm. Macam apa yang macam doktor cakap lah, macam kita gunakan apa ni, apologize. Macam kadang bila kita macam pihak polis tahan, kadang apa yang berlaku, kadang apa ni, netizen ni dia macam marah-marah pihak polis tau yang jaga. So, lepas tu kadang dokumen diorang tak lengkap, diorang macam bila kita cakap macam dia argue, oh, dia argue betul melawan. Itu sebab sebenarnya macam kita yang jaga dekat sekatan jalan ni, kadang kita pun penat juga. Tapi sebenarnya kita pun guna atas budi bicara. Kalau kadang netizen cakap baik-baik, kadang kita tak ada saman pun. Tapi yang jadi isu macam just saya nak bagi orang kata apa, macam nasihat lah pada apa team member dengan netizen kat luar kan. Macam bila kita ada orang kata macam sekatan jalan, kita kena guna budi bicara lah, kena cakap cara baik lah, baru kita orang kata apa, barulah kita pihak polis yang jaga tu dah penat. Itu yang kalau kadang dia terus kasi saman. Kalau kita guna cara yang baik macam tadi doktor cakap tu, apologize cara yang tu. So biasanya jarang kita akan saman apa netizen ni yang mana yang langgar hal-hal kecil lah, macam tak bawa dokumen semua. Itu just nasihat saya je lah untuk yang COVID-19 ni kan. Banyak isu pasal saman kan mahal lah sekarang kan, RM1,000 ke RM5,000 kan.
Betul, RM1,002, bukan RM1,002, RM1,500 dengan RM2,000, RM2,000 ke atas dah sekarang.
Betul.
Betul, I agree with Syafian. So because nowadays, we need to know that everybody are exhausted. Memang sekarang betul-betul semua fatigue, semua penat. Okay, I just share experience with related to apa tu apologize ni. There's one day, there was one time few months ago kot. Okay, I was driving from Janda Baik nak balik lah. It was raining. Okay, masa tu saya tak perasan yang saya bawa kereta tu laju, and then come to the SJR sampai dekat sekatan jalan raya tu. So polis tu stop saya. So dia tanya, first dia tanya, "Cik nak pergi mana ni laju-laju ni? Nampak tak kita orang ni? Semua ni nyawa tau." The first thing that I said, "Cik, saya betul-betul minta maaf sebab saya rasa saya bawa dah perlahan." Kan, the first thing. But after that, we end up with both of us laughing with each other. So maksudnya, kan, but somehow saya pun rasa I feel guilty jugalah. Sebab saya pun tak perasan sebab saya tekan minyak. Sebab masa tu memang tengah hujan dan ada sekatan jalan raya, in which saya dekat depan tu tak ada kereta. So that's why lah mungkin saya tekan minyak sikit kot, tiba-tiba saya pun tak perasan. So in which at that time, it is a difficult time, okay. So we need to respect each other. Respect each other ni bukannya maksudnya we compromise on something that is betul wrong, bukan. Okay, we also need to consider other people as well. So kita tahu yang semua orang tengah penat, orang yang berdiri tengah panas tu memang penat, bukan senang. Okay, and then another thing that I would like to advise to everyone, other than apa yang Syafian share tadi, okay, we need to respect others' feeling in social media as well. Okay, this one sangat kena jaga-jaga. Okay, sebab sekarang ni ramai sangat, banyak sangat isu mahkamah, dia melibatkan saman-saman yang melibatkan posting di social media. Okay, betul yang, so terlalu banyak.
Doktor, macam dan tambah sikit. Okay, untuk yang social media, sebenarnya untuk kita orang dekat Bukit Aman sendirilah, maybe netizen tak tahu, tapi ni just untuk sharing lah. Sebenarnya untuk social media, kita ada satu unit tau yang khas monitor untuk setiap apa ni yang kita posting dekat social media tau. So sekarang ni waktu dia start tahun lepas lah, tak silap saya, sebab saya pun ada pernah masuk meeting kan. So mana yang apa ni macam social media yang ada macam kita panggil kesalahan lah. Kita rasa macam ada macam hugutan. Biasanya macam dulu kita ada yang unit apa ni, macam kadang macam apa, commercial tu, ada something lah unit yang biasa kat ground ni yang akan buat report, ataupun kita tunggu report daripada apa ni, macam orang awam ke apa. Tapi sekarang kita pihak polis sendiri, kita boleh buat report ke atas apa social media tu. So maksud dia sekarang ni lagi laju sebenarnya. Maksud dia kalau contoh, sebab kita ada satu unit yang khas monitor pasal social media ni. Contoh macam saya contohlah macam kita macam contoh doktor ada posting something yang benda yang apa kita panggil macam mengganggu gugat keselamatan awam kan. Macam dulu kita ambil masa tau sebab kita tunggu apa ni pihak yang tercabar tu untuk buat report. Tapi sekarang tak, kalau pihak polis rasa posting tu sendiri membawa apa kata macam ada something kesalahan,
pihak
polis tu sendiri akan buat report. Tu besar sekarang ni kena bagi untuk macam nasihat saya sebagai pegawai lah kan, pegawai polis ni. So apa benda yang you posting, you make sure benda tu jangan sampai you boleh kena jelaskan. Sebab benda tu memang kita ada apa atas hasutan atas komunikasi multimedia. So benda tu memang real thing, memang benda tu kita monitor. So you kena apa netizen sekarang kena be aware lah benda ni. Kita tak nak benda dah kena, terutamanya yang apa tu government kan, government. So bila you kena tindakan tata tertib, nanti you akan effect dari segi apa kata kita panggil you punya kejayaan lah kan.
Itu another thing on technical part lah eh. The other part is the emotional and psychological part. Yang sekarang ni this one, that one untuk teknol apa tu the technical part and the legal part. Okay, ini boleh dikenakan tata apa tu dikenakan tata tertib ataupun dikenakan tindakan undang-undang. But another and on another side is the psychological part, emotional part. Okay, sebab kadang sometimes our posting at work because apa tu the sharing is now sangat laju. Kita pun faham benda tu. Anybody can read our post. Okay, in which sometimes kita rasa benda tu tak offense on other, tak offended, tak nak tak we do not have intention to offend anybody pun. But sometimes there might people that feel hurt, that get hurt with the post. Okay, and but we need to aware that currently memang kita semua akan banyak spend masa dengan dekat social media, dekat online. Okay, and then our feelings and our psychological state ni will easily get get challenge ataupun akan cepat terganggu. Okay, dengan posting-posting yang depending on the people. B40 dia punya cara lain, M40 lain, T20 lain, ataupun orang yang terkena COVID lain. Okay, dia punya the situation are different. Orang yang mungkin berkahwin lain, orang yang single parents lain, okay, orang yang single pun lain. Okay, therefore, but cara penerimaan orang tu, how we derive the information, how we interpret the information tu are different from different people. So that's why we need to be extra careful, okay, with these words, with the words that we post in our social media. Okay, itu sahaja pesanan saya. Okay, so another thing that you want to say or ask regarding the assignment, regarding our lecture today. So I thought we might have another last lecture and then kita akan ada lagi satu kita akan arrange satu sesi untuk presentation. Ini saya arrange ni.
Yang maksud dia yang satu lagi tu based on third class ke ataupun extra class ke?
Saya buat kelas suka hati saya.
Sebab kita kalau ikutkan yang third class tu 26 bulan 6 kan.
Tak apalah, kita buat lagi satu. Sebabnya saya nak discuss pasal please have a look on the case study. Sebab macam saya kata tadi, case study tu one of it will be included in our final exam. And our final exam is actually based on a real situation and based on your own reflection. Nanti final exam tu sebenarnya saya akan ada share beberapa artikel related to current situation dan saya nak you all bagi respon dengan situasi tu. Okay, sebenarnya apa yang soalan saya tu sebenarnya soalan practical. Okay, practical. Okay. There might be no right or wrong, depends on your situation, depends on your argument. So it is possible for you to mention any laws or regulation that applicable to the case. So sama macam case study tadi, so you all tengok case tu satu-satu and then we will discuss in the next session. Okay, kalau boleh, kalau satu group boleh prepare dalam bentuk slide pun boleh. Okay, kita ada 17 orang, saya check pagi ni 17 orang, lepas tu ada satu lagi tadi mungkin dia dah drop class, so because I've seen that he or she have left the group. So saya rasa mungkin kita ada 16, so kita tengok berapa group yang boleh ada dan setiap group kalau boleh ambil satu case tadi. Untuk kita next session kita buat presentation lah. Presentation on so that you all boleh practice sebenarnya. Kalau let's say situasi konflik ni apa yang kita boleh buat. Okay, based on that case studies tu. Faham?
Okay,
so any other question regarding the case study? Nampaknya saya rasa video ni saya tak boleh cut, memang nak kena post inilah semua yang saya kena post supaya you all dapat the whole content of the lecture. Okay, so any other question before we stop for today? Cukuplah 2 jam ni. 2 jam setengah lah, 2 jam. Okay, so with that, I would like to end our session today. I would like to postpone our session. So thank you everyone for joining me today. So see you again.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you. Stay safe, everyone. Thank you. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you, Doctor. Okay.